Welcome to the arena. This is workshop 201 with Father Greg Boyle, with the title, Be Fearless for Me, Courage and the Gospel of the Marginalized. My name is Dominic Nears, and I'm with the Office of Religious Education in Los Angeles as the coordinator of adult faith formation. Please take a moment to silence your cell phones, and then we will take a moment to silence ourselves for prayer. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. O God of loving kindness, open our eyes and ears to the needs of all. Give us your Spirit that we may be an instrument of your peace and justice. Bless all who gather here this weekend with your wisdom. We ask this in Jesus' holy name. Amen. It's my honor and pleasure to introduce to you Father Greg Boyle. So for most of you, I could just stop here, but he is the founder and executive director of Homeboy Industries. The largest gang intervention, rehabilitation, and re-entry program in the United States, now in its 26th year. A native Angeleno, Father Greg was ordained a Jesuit priest in 1984. He was transformed by his work in Bolivia, Mexico, and Folsom Prison with those who live at the margins, and his dedication to finding a place for all in our society brought him to the Boyle Heights community of Los Angeles. It was there Father Greg started what would become Homeboy Industries, a nonprofit organization that employs, trains, and provides critical free services to the more than 300 former gang members who work in Homeboy's social enterprises, as well as the 12,000 people who walk through the doors of Homeboy Industries every year seeking a better life. Homeboy Industries is also just a good place to get lunch, to buy a cake, or what you can also get there is Father Greg Boyle's New York Times best-selling book, Tattoos on the Heart, The Power of Boundless Compassion. So please welcome Father Greg Boyle.
Thank you. I don't necessarily agree with you, but thank you very much for your... If I could ask you all to take a moment to kindly lower your expectations, I'll wait. There we go. Thank you. I'm going to do this. Probably going to drive people crazy that I do this, but I like to do it. Okay. I remember a homie named Hector came into my office, a very earnest fellow who, had walked away from his gang and gang activity and stepped away from getting high, was in school, was working for us. And he plunked himself down in my office, and he was trying his hand at small talk. And he said, I ran into this man who attended your talk at the Religious Ed Congress. I said, really? He said, yes, he found your talk rather monotonous. I said, wow, he did? No, actually, that didn't happen, but I need practice using bigger words. So I asked him to practice somewhere else. A lot of you have heard my stuff before, and every once in a while, you think you're a theological tree climbing, and your musings are, kind of half-baked, but who has time to bake anymore, And so, and you can't please everybody. It's one of those things, as you grow older, you let go of trying to do that. I was in New Orleans, and I was speaking, did a keynote in the morning for a group of 500 psychologists. And then afterwards, after an hour talk, I went to the French Quarter to get breakfast. Then I came back, and I was in the elevator to go to my room, get my bags, and go to the airport. I was the only one in the elevator, and I'm in the back of the elevator when suddenly the whole elevator fills with people, and they're all wearing lanyards and badges from this conference that I spoke at earlier. They don't see me there, and I'm at the back of the elevator crushed in, and we're all up against each other. And the doors close, and there's a woman at the front of the door, and she says to nobody in particular, "You know that talk this morning, that Father Doyle?" Well, I'm thinking maybe she needs a lifeline from me, and I said, "Don't talk shit, I'm on the elevator." I spared her. So for 30 years, I've worked with gang members, and the day won't ever come when I am more noble, or I have more courage, or I am closer to God than the thousands of men and women I've been privileged to know. I can't imagine a way to have been given access to the tenderness of God more surely than through these men and women I've come to know. I've been noticing lately, because I get around and do a lot of things, and I give a lot of talks. Plus, Homeboy Industries has started a thing called the Global Homeboy Network. And there are 47 programs in the United States and 11 programs outside the country that are born of the model of Homeboy. And so I spend a lot of time doing that. Well, what's deeply heartening for me is to have homies and homegirls who kind of run the place. Years ago, I used to get questions about succession plan, and I don't get them anymore, which I'm really happy that I don't, because the homies run the place, they own the place. People like Luis Perez, who I first met at Camp Miller, a probation camp detention facility where he made his first communion, and I knew him all the years since. He's in his early 30s, been to prison, shot collar, tattooed. He was a heroin addict for a time and a homeless man. He and I direct retreats lately, which is kind of a new thing. He loves St. Ignatius of Loyola. He reads about him. He calls him the original gangster. So I'm waiting for his book on that. And he's become quite a good speaker, and he was giving me tips on how to speak publicly. And we were at dinner, and he said, "You know, you gotta pepper your talk with self-defecating humor." "Yeah, no shit," I said. So prepare for my peppering. But I always, when I speak, it's peppered with stories, because we like stories. Rumi, the poet, addresses God and says, "The moment I heard my first story, I started looking for you." And I think that's our experience. The homies also experience that, I think, when they tell their stories. The homies discover what Maya Angelou says, which seems to be quite true. There is no greater agony then bearing an untold story inside of you. So all our stories send us searching for the God of tenderness. And so this afternoon, I want to begin with God, the God who is always greater, as St. Ignatius tells us. Again, the poet Rumi addresses God as the friend. He writes, "Start the drumbeat. Everything we have said about the friend is true. The beauty of that peacefulness makes the whole world restless. It doesn't make the world anxious. It doesn't make the world uncomfortable, but restless because it unearths our longing for what a Jesuit friend of mine says, we all need a better God than the one we have. We're restless for that because we fall into a place where our sense of who God is atrophies, and we settle for a partial God, a tiny God, a God created in our own image. And so we always are trying to move from a child consciousness to an adult consciousness because it matters what kind of God we believe in. I had a homie walk into my office with his 5-year-old son, and they're standing in front of my desk and I'm at my chair. And the homie says, he has a question for you. So I lean forward and the kid is very nervous but determined. And he says, does God have hair? And does he wear a robe? And I said, yes, and only when he steps out of the shower. Whatever our 5-year-old sense of who God is obviously not the sense of who God is for us now. And if that change has happened, why wouldn't our conception of who God is change 20 minutes from now? If we're attentive, it will. I was thinking, Yogi Berra died this year, and the homies and the homegirls, they kind of out-yogi Yogi. They're always kind of mangling the language in a very charming way. I had a homegirl come to my office with her man. It was at the end of the day he came to pick her up. And she says, this is my sufficient other. No doubt. You know, because I'm on the road a lot with this Global Homeboy Network and trying to help cities reimagine a different response to their gang situation, fortunately for Homeboy, we have a CEO, Tom Volso, and we're now an $18 million annual operation, and I don't want nor know how to do that. So it's nice that he's in charge. So I had a homie in my office one morning, and he said, damn, G, my lady, she's in a bad mood. I said, why? Well, you know, she's beginning her administration period. I said, yeah, well, I'm just ending mine, so kind of know what she's going through. My favorite one happened at San Fernando Juvenile Hall, and this was in the old days in a gym packed with like 300 gang members. And as a presider, you know, sometimes I sat in my chair and I closed my eyes. I wanted to listen to the words being proclaimed by the homies who would come up. And so I had my little hoja, the little sheet that had the readings so you could follow along. But I had it on my lap. And I'm listening to this kid who's doing a Psalm 138 or something. And he's kind of speaking with an overabundance of confidence. And he says, the Lord is exhausted. And I say, what the hell? And I look at my sheet and it said, the Lord is exalted. And I thought, wow, that's way better. If you think about it, you know, exalted is lifted up, elevated is where the word comes from. Elevated, lifted up where? Far from us. And I know that if I was God, I would want to be exalted. I would want to be far, way up there. And yet our personal experience tells us that God wants to be close and intimate and united and whispering in our ear. And our God is exhausted loving us, too busy loving us to ever be disappointed in us. St. Ignatius asks us to enter into the vision of God. And that's the hope, that's the refinement that's asked of us constantly. So we start to understand that we do have a better God than we thought we had, because our consciousness grows and we discover the spacious expanse of God. The truth of the matter is, our God is too good to be true. And because we're human beings, whenever we bump into something we think is too good to be true, we decide it's not true. The poet Hafez offers an image that I like better. God and I have become like two giant fat people living in a tiny boat. We keep bumping into each other and laughing. That's way better than the exalted God that wants to be held at a distance rather than the one that's always wanting to bump into us and laugh. The goal, of course, is to always grow more and more comfortable in God's tenderness. St. Ignatius talks about majus, which of course means more, but it's really about a growing affection for God. But it's the God who wants to be tender with us. It's the God who wants to be intimate with us. It's the God who exhausts God's self in loving us. No time left for all the things that we think God is occupied with, like being disappointed in us. Years ago, I was a chaplain at Folsom Prison, and there was a guy there we all called the Fat Man, and he was a big, huge guy, had a big Rasputin beard, and he had been involved in prison politics for a long time until he hung up his gloves, and he had been a heroin addict even in prison until he stopped that and discovered recovery. Every single day when I was there, he would come up to me at the end of the day and he'd say, let's do some laps. And so we'd walk around the yard and he'd talk about God. And the conversations altered me. And when they ended, he'd always say the same thing. He'd look at me and he'd say, before he gave me a big hug, who loves you, baby? And he'd give me a big hug. And then he'd point at me and he'd say, I love you like a rock. And then after that, with the homies, whenever I wrote them letters, I would always end with, love you like a rock. In my office, when I'd have a conversation with them, I'd end with that. In fact, homies would sort of say it before I did. I know, you love me like a rock. I preached at his funeral when he had been released. He got out, and a month later he had was reacquainted with heroin, and it was too much for him. But I mentioned to the packed church about the love you like a rock, and it turned out like he had said this to everybody, but they nodded because they knew that in the end, for all that this man struggled with, he had found his way to the tenderness of God, and for that there can be no doubt. And so we just find our way to love spending this stillness with God, always returning to the center. My life can be kind of hectic, especially yesterday I was in the office all day, and it's chaotic. And I'm the priest the homies mistook for an ATM machine. And so you're trying to get from one thing to the next, and I have this red thread here, and not to be a name dropper, but the Dalai Lama gave it to me. And I spoke in San Francisco once. He was the opening keynote, and I was the closing keynote at this luncheon. And so he was sitting there in this easy chair in my view on the stage as I spoke, and he even laughed, which has to be on everybody's bucket list, you know, visit Machu Picchu, check, make the Dalai Lama laugh, check. But he had this thread, and he blessed it, and so he held it to his forehead, and then he blew on it, and I tied it, and I've never taken it off because it has this knot mysteriously in the middle of it. And I always, all day long, I try to keep it in the center, and the day will go, and it'll become sort of whoppy-jawed and off-kilter, and I bring it back to the center because that is the only thing I long for in each day, for this tender God to be at the center of my life. I've discovered as I have evolved that it's just not necessary for me to have God be in charge of my life, but only at the center of it. Because when we're kids, we're like that. We think God is in charge and God has a big plan, when I think God is just too busy loving us to be able to make too many plans for us. I think things happen, things are random, some things are in our control. And the Serenity Prayer helps us understand that the difference between the things that aren't. I don't find it necessary to believe that God protects me from anything, but only that God sustains me in everything. That's come a lot from having worked for 30 years with gang members. You know, all of us get those emails, the ones that we'll talk about. You know, there's that one about 9/11 and about all these annoying things we go through in life. I was stuck in traffic on 9/11 and I had to go pick up the donuts for the office. And my kid has had his first day of kindergarten. And because of all these annoyances, they didn't get to work that day in the World Trade Center. And then people, of course, say how blessed and how protected and how God was watching over us even in these annoyances. But, of course, it begs the question about all those who perished. Did God turn some blind eye? And because I live and work and walk and have my life altered by people who live hugely unprotected lives, I only believe in the God who sustains us and in the God who is at the center, not the God who helps us pass the math test when we haven't studied. So the hope is to find the inner absorption of God and rest in that stillness, always in God's immense tenderness. People often, when I travel and give talks, they ask me about losing my faith, and the presumption is Because I've buried 202 young people killed because of gang violence, they presume that somehow this has shaken my faith, when my experience of it is more true to say that it's shaped my faith. But part of our hardwiring is to think in exactly those terms. Sometimes our task as we grow in allowing the tenderness of God to reach us, we're a little bit like Tom Cruise in some Mission Impossible movie, where we have to detonate or dismantle these wires, the green wire from the red one or from the blue one, so it doesn't blow up. Recognizing our hardwiring is part of the task, it seems to me. It's like a little kid who hands his father a watercolor painting that he drew, and the father looks at it and says, "What is this?" And the kid says, "It's a tree with a whole bunch of leaves, but it really looks like vomit." And no father hands this painting back to his kid and says, "Come back when it looks like a tree." But that's part of our hardwiring. It's a little bit of how we imagine things. I gave a talk once at a Shishi Fufu private school in Los Angeles. In the evening, to the parents, there were no students there, but it was a packed room, and I could see in the front row was this kid. I found out his name was Diego. He was 10 years old. He was clearly the youngest person in the audience. And I was doing my thing and telling my stories, and the kid was just slapping his knee. He was laughing at all the funny stuff. And he was gasping at all the stuff you gasp at. And I was thinking to myself as I watched him, as I was sort of out of body, putting my talk on automatic pilot, I thought, wow, how does this kid get all this? I mean, he really is getting it. Then I end the talk with a story that I tell often about these two kids, Puppet and Youngster, and about Puppet being beaten to death, and they were enemies. And I'm looking out at the audience, and the adults are just sort of flicking tears, not wanting to be noticed that they were being moved. But not Diego. Diego was sobbing. He was just weeping at how the story ended. He had grown to love the kid in the story, and to have him die was more than he could bear. And he's just sobbing, and I'm watching him from my other perch, and I'm thinking, wow, amazing that this kid is so moved. And then I watch his mother. She looks at him, and with a gentle smile, and she reaches over very slowly, and she puts her arm right on his shoulder. And the minute she makes contact, what he does next is a showstopper. He looks at her, and he says, "What?" And anyone who's ever raised an adolescent, or anyone who has ever been an adolescent, knows exactly what that is. And the whole room stops. I stopped speaking because it was quite something. He demurs a little, and then he leans into her, "What?" And of course, you know exactly what it means. It means, "What have I done to disappoint you? What is it that you would like me to do? What is it that you want from me?" And yet I watched it, and it was so abundantly clear that all the mother wanted to do was to communicate two truths to her kid. How did I get so lucky to have a son like you? And whatever breaks your heart breaks mine too. We get this. It is what a parent does. But it's also what our God does. A God who doesn't want anything from us, but only wants for us, that you may be one, that my joy may be yours and your joy complete. Happiness, peace. I don't want anything from you. I just want for you, because I am a God who exhausts myself in loving you. Just accept my tenderness. Cardinal Walter Kasper at the conclave that elected Pope Francis went up to Jorge Bergoglio and handed him a copy of his book, Mercy, which had been translated into Spanish. And famously, the Pope, the then Cardinal Bergoglio, accepted the book and he said, Mercy, that's the name of our God. And indeed it is. It matters less that we believe in God, and it matters more what kind of God you believe in. For the judge at the Boston Marathon bombing, when he sentenced to death the kid who did it, he quoted Othello's, of Verdi's Othello, and says, I believe in a cruel God. It matters what we believe. We have a God who's too good to be true, and so how do we inhabit this sense of God's own generosity with us? No need to measure up. We just want to show up to it. In this time of Lent, it's not about giving stuff up. It's about giving into the tenderness of God. I remember I had a homie who got out of camp, a detention facility, and I gave him a gift card for $200 at Sears. And a week later, he's in my office. He says, you know that card you gave me for clothes? Well, I lost it. I said, wait, and you want me to give you another one? No, no, that would be ridiculous. Could you? And it's funny, you know, because we're always, as part of our hardwiring, that we don't get generosity. We always think someone is trying to pull a fast one. And we don't like that. We don't like being saps. We don't like being duped. We don't want anyone to, pull the wool over our eyes, or as the homies say, pull the wool out of your eyes. And so we can't really see how spaciously generous our God is. And so we have this allergy to not wanting to be taken advantage of. Years ago, I was interviewed by Anderson Cooper at our old office. And reporters, people like that, interviewers, they can like you, but they can't completely like you. They have to prove that they're hard-edged and they can ask the question. So usually they'll get some input as to the hard question from people who oppose you. And in my case, often enough, it's police. So he says, well, but the police here in Hollenbeck Station say you're naive, that gang members take advantage of you. And I always have the answer to that at the ready. And I said, no one can take your advantage if you're giving your advantage. Well, years later, he came back to interview me in our new headquarters, and we're sitting in the bakery before the filming begins. And he says, by the way, I use your line a lot with my friends because they'll say you're naive and people are taking advantage of you. And I say, why, no one can take advantage of me if I'm giving my advantage. And I thanked him, and I wondered if there were any royalties involved in using this. But homies are like that all the time. You know, I'm in all these camps, and I've given out 5 billion of my cards. And recently, a homie said, real tough little guy, hey, can I have one of your cards? I said, sure. So I handed it to him like this, and he grabbed it, and he goes, there's nothing on it. And I go, well, he didn't know that you could just turn it over. But his hardwiring was, are you trying to pull a fast one? And so we're somehow asked to fully enter into the open-handed thrill of God's abundance, the God who is too good to be true. I remember years ago, there was a homie I knew named Thumper who called me and he said, hey, G, can you take me to take my driving test? I don't have a car. And I said, sure. And he told me the date. And I said, oh, by the way, do you know how to drive? And he said, come on, I'm on it like bubonic, he said. Besides, I went to the G-Ride School of Driving. So he'd stolen enough cars, he was apparently in good shape. So I picked him up in Boyle Heights, and we were going to go to the Montebello DMV. And I said, well, look, why don't you take over the wheel just so you can get used to my car? Híjole madre santa, it was Mr. Toad's wild ride. The worst driver who had ever sat behind the wheel. And I have no idea how we got to the Montebello DMV. But as we're pulling in like this, and I'm trying to kind of lower his expectations, I said, you know, son, not everybody passes their driving test the first time, you know. And so I'm trying to kind of get him used to the fact that there's no way he's going to pass this thing. When I see the driving inspector, a woman is walking towards us with her clipboard. And I went, oh my God, it's Maria. She grew up in Aliso Village. I did her quinceañera. I've baptized her kids. So I turned to Thumper and I said, hey, mijo, unless you mow down a pedestrian, you may actually pass this thing. So Maria comes up to me with her attitude of the driving inspector, and then she sees me, gee, and get out of the car, and I give her a big hug, and please step aside, sir, and she winks, you know, very professional, and they take off. And I'm waiting for a long time in the parking lot, like the expectant father, you know. And then I see them. They've parked very far away in some nether region of the parking lot. And the two of them are walking towards the where I am and at some distance. But I'm trying to register and read and see any indication, did you pass it? And then Miguel takes one step back so she doesn't see and two thumbs up, you know, and he passed it. And then they're walking at the same pace. And then Maria, it's her turn. She takes a step back and, ay, Dios mío. And she makes quite the elaborate personándose. And our God is pretty damn generous. Too good to be true. And we join God then, once we can enter into that spaciousness, in thinking that there's always plenty to go around. Ours is not a God of scarcity, but of abundance. And when you have enough, you have plenty. In Buddhism, they believe that generosity is to be relieved of the stain of stinginess. And we're always trying to work against that. We're human beings. We can't help ourselves, but we can catch ourselves. And we somehow want to be in the world who God is, generous and merciful and kind and compassionate. There's a homegirl I know, we'll call her Letty. And Letty's had a hard life. Find me something she hasn't suffered. Unprotected, really, against some of the most terrible things imaginable. Her resume reads prostitute, gang member, drug addict. She's suffered that particular pain of having your kids taken from you and raised by strangers. Her growing up was a period of constant surrounding of terror and torture, abuse, violence, and neglect and abandonment. And I know that I would not survive one day of her childhood. I stand in awe at what she's had to carry. So she's in my office sitting in front of my desk, and I can't remember why she's there. Maybe she needs help. Maybe they're going to cut off her lights. She's a famous chillona. She always cries. She's very sensitive. And she looks at me and she sighs and she says, "Damn, G, I wish you were God." And I chuckle. I say, "Why?" And then she starts to cry and she says, "I think you'd let me into heaven." And then it's my turn to become a chillon. And I reach across the expanse of the desk and I grab her hands and I pull her as close as I can. And we look in each other's eyes and tears are streaming down our faces. And I say, "Letty, I swear to you, if I get to heaven and you're not there, I'm not staying." And we stared for a very long time at each other, crying and discovering that God is not an interrogation lamp, but a warm, gentle sun. An inmate at Folsom once told me, "Grand is the smile of God." And yet, truth be told, we always think scowl and furrowed forehead and shaking head in disgust. We can move to the Cana wedding and we can discover that the ordinary water of how we see ourselves gets transformed into the exquisite wine of how God sees us. We enter into the vision of God. At Homeboy Industries, we have our 18-month program, and at the end of this period, a homie came to me on his last day, and he said, "I fell in like with myself here." Add that to the list of things God wants for us. "You are my beloved, in whom I'm wonderfully pleased." Go ahead. Fall in like with yourself. I know over 30 years, there's always some kids that are kind of in the back recesses of your mind. You kind of say to yourself, "Yeah, I don't know. I'm not so sure this guy's going to be able to steer this ship around." You never acknowledge that to anybody, but you think of it occasionally. And of course, it's that guy who's Luis Perez, who's currently running Homeboy Industries while I'm here. It always works that way. There was a kid named Danny who I met when he was 13. And I never met him at Homeboy Industries because he told me, he says, "I will never step foot in Homeboy Industries." And he was a knucklehead. He was into his gang and did a lot of dirt and a handful. So I'd meet him on the streets with his homies, and then I'd meet him in juvenile hall, and then I'd bump into him again in a probation camp. And finally, at 18, he went to prison for 2 years. And when he gets out, he discovers that his mother has 6 months to live. She's dying of cancer. And so he sat by her side with great tenderness And in recovery, they say it takes what it takes. The birth of a son, the death of a friend, a long stretch in prison, a mother dying of cancer. And he was like this hospice caregiver as his mom breathed her last. So then we buried her, and a week later he's in my office. And now he works side by side with enemies, rivals. And I watch him as he laughs with his crewmates and the maintenance crew, and who can believe it? So one day he came into my office and he said, I have to tell you about what happened yesterday after work. It's something that's never happened to me in my whole life. And he tells me that at 5 he left the building and got on the Chinatown Gold Line train heading east to go home. He says the car he's on is packed, but he found a seat. Standing in front of him, hanging on to a pole, is a guy he says he's medio pedo, a little bit drunk. He's a homie, he says, because he sees the tattoos, but he's older than Danny, and Danny doesn't know who he is. And Danny is wearing a t-shirt, huge t-shirt that says, Homeboy Industries, Jobs, Not Jails. And the medio drunk guy says, hey, you work there? And Danny doesn't know whether to engage him or not, and so kind of just nods. And then the guy says, is it any good? And Danny shrugs and says, I don't know, it's helped me. In fact, I don't think I'll go back to prison because of this place. And then Danny stands, and he reaches into his pocket, and he pulls out a piece of paper, and he finds a pen, and he stands in front of this guy, and he writes the address of Homeboy Industries on the piece of paper. As he's telling me this, he says, I couldn't believe I knew the address by heart. And so he finishes it and he hands it to the guy and he says, come see us. We'll help you. And the guy studies the piece of paper and he says, thank you. And the train stops and the guy gets off and Danny sits down. But now he's starting to buckle under the weight of the emotion of this and he says, what happened to me next has never happened to me in my life. Everyone on the train looked at me. Everyone on the train nodded at me. Everyone on the train smiled at me. And then he could barely speak. And for the first time in my life, I felt admired. And God doesn't want anything from us. He only wants for us to be returned to ourselves in a community of tenderness. That's God's dream come true. And it only happens if we give in to this tenderness that God wants to give to us. We don't reach for it. We just let it happen to us. There was a kid, famous kid, Pee-Pee, who kind of grew up in our office and kind of a slow poke, and kids always made fun of him, and my office staff, they would teach him how to tell time and how to remember what day was his birthday. But he was a kid who was hugely neglected and loved the attention he got at Homeboy Industries. And one day I'm saying mass, the 5 o'clock vigil mass on a hot summer day, and I'm just about to begin my homily when the side door flings open and it's little tiny, scrawny, skinny 10-year-old Peepy. And he flings out his arms and he's just beside himself, apoplectic with joy. And I said, "Peepy, what is it?" And he says, "I'm finding you." And that's better than the exalted God, the God who is beside himself saying, "I'm finding you." The poet Mirabai writes, "Love's knife entered my heart. Now God has bound me tightly with that fine thread. He takes me wherever he will." He's finding you. And where are we being taken? Well, that leads me to the church. John Howard Yoder says that the church is called to be now what the world is called to be ultimately. And I've come to think, as a microcosm, Homeboy Industries is called to be now what the church is called to be ultimately. For the three people here who don't know what Homeboy Industries is, I'll give the cliff notes. It was born in 1988 when I was pastor of the poorest parish in L.A., Dolores Mission. Two housing projects, huge, eight gangs, the highest concentration of gang activity anywhere in the city. If L.A. was the gang capital of the world, my parish was the gang capital of Los Angeles at the time. We buried a lot of kids during the decade of death, which was 88 to 98. First thing we did was we started a school because there's so many junior high age gang members given the boot from their home school, nobody wanted them. And so they were wreaking havoc in the projects and violent and selling drugs. And so I went out to them and I said, if I found a school that would take you, would you go? And then to my surprise, they all said yes. And then I couldn't find a school that would take them. So it forced my hand. So our elementary school was across the street from our church, and first two floors, the parochial school. But the entire third floor was the convent. So I gathered all the nuns in the living room, and I said, "Hey, you know, would you guys mind moving out?" And and, you know, we could start a school for gang members. And they said, "Sure." So they brought gang members to the church, which upset the apple cart, because aren't churches supposed to be hermetically sealed? Good people in, bad people out. Then they said, if only we had jobs. And then myself and the women, we marched around the factories that surrounded the housing projects trying to find felony-friendly employers. That wasn't so forthcoming, so we invented crews, graffiti removal crew, landscaping, maintenance, a crew to build the child care center. Then the unrest happened in 92. Our community didn't ignite, and everybody thought it would explode. And so the LA Times asked me, and I said, "I think it's because we had 60 strategically hired gang members who may have been most likely to ignite." And they didn't. They were invested. And so a movie producer with $500 million named Ray Stark summoned me, and I said, "Break bread, Ray." And he said, "What should I do with my money?" And I said, "Well, just why don't you buy this bakery across the street from the church? It has ovens. It's abandoned. We could put hairnets on rival gang members. They could bake bread. We could call it Homeboy Bakery." And he said, "Sure." So we were off and running, and that was the extent of my business plan. But and then we started Homeboy Tortillas a month later, and once we had plural, we came up with the highfalutin Homeboy Industries, as if there was any industry involved. Not everything worked. Homeboy Plumbing was really not hugely successful. Who knew? People didn't want gang members in their homes. Somebody should have told me that. And now nobody intends to do something as crazy as we just backed into what we are now, which is the largest gang intervention rehab reentry program on our planet. And all these thousands of gang members walk in and we try to help them reimagine their lives. Tattoo removal, therapy, everybody's in therapy, case management, curricular offerings from anger management to parenting. We still have a school. And we have all our enterprises from Homeboy Bakery to solar panel installation to silkscreen, two restaurants at the airport, a Homeboy Diner, the only place you can get food in City Hall. We have the lunch truck. We have Homeboy Grocery, where we sell our chips and salsas and all the Ralphs from Ventura County to San Diego. And Homegirl Cafe, where women with records, young ladies from rival gangs, waitresses with attitude will gladly take your order. It's a who's who if you go there for, it's only open lunch and breakfast and lunch, and always there are electeds, and Jim Carrey has gone there many times, and Pandemonium whenever he goes, and Jack Black, the actor, and some months ago, you know, we, with only a few hours notice, we were, the Secret Service called us and said that Vice President Joe Biden, you know, wanted to have lunch there. And so motorcade and entourage and selfies with the Vice President. I was making my annual retreat, so I wasn't there. And so when I got back to the office, Louis Mora, one of the homies, debriefed me. While you were gone, we were visited by an MVP. I said, do you mean a VIP? That one. Imagine, gee, here at Homeboy Industries, we were visited by the Vice President of the United States, Mick Romney. So we're thinking of adding a current affairs class to our to our curriculum. Most famously, Diane Keaton showed up, Oscar-winning actress, Godfather movies, Annie Hall. She was there with a regular, a guy who was there often enough, and her waitress is Glinda. Glinda's a big girl, been there, done that, tattooed, been to prison, felon, parolee. She has no idea who Diane Keaton is, and so she's taking her order, and Diane Keaton says, well, what do you recommend? And Glinda rattles off the three platillos that she particularly likes, and then Diane Keaton says, well, I'll have that second one. You know, that one sounds good. And it's at that moment that something dawns on Glinda. She goes, wait a minute. I feel like I know you from somewhere. You know, like maybe we've met. And Diane Keaton decides to deflect it humbly. Oh, gosh, I don't know. I suppose I have one of those faces, you know, that people think they've seen before. And then Glenda goes, no, now I know. We were locked up together. Well, now that just took my breath away. I don't believe we've had any further Diane Keaton sightings now that I think of it. But suddenly, kinship so quickly, connection, exquisite mutuality, Oscar-winning actress, attitudinal waitress, exactly what God had in mind, as Jesus tells us, that you may be one. That's what's on God's mind. The God who exhausts God's self in loving us, so generous that God doesn't want anything from us, only for us. And Homeboy Industries wants to be now what the church is called to be ultimately. I was reading a magazine, and there was a Q&A with Whoopi Goldberg, and they asked her, what living person do you most admire? And she said, Pope Francis. And then she says, yeah, he's going with the original program. And I like that because I think that appeals to us. We want to go with the original program. The original program, of course, is the covenant between God and God's people, where God says, as I have loved you exhaustively, we think that the sentence is to be finished this way, and so we will love you back. But that's not on God's mind. God says, as I have loved you, so must you have a preferential, special love for the widow and the orphan and the stranger. And God chooses these subgroupings of the poor because he knows that the widow, orphan, and the stranger are folks who know what it's like to have been cut off. And because they have suffered this particular pain, God thinks they're trustworthy to guide the rest of us to the birth of a new inclusion to a community of kinship such that God, in fact, might recognize it. Famously, when Jorge Bergoglio was named a pope, the cardinal from Brazil walked up to him, hugged him, and whispered in his ear, don't forget the poor. Indeed, he hasn't. Being church and being part of the original program is wanting to take seriously what Jesus took seriously. And here is what I think Jesus takes seriously. Inclusion, nonviolence, unconditional loving kindness, acceptance. So recently there was a kerfuffle between the Pope and Donald Trump. And, you know, the media probably would suggest, you know, that Trump won the day because how dare the Pope insert himself into American politics? Well, he was answering a question in the back of the plane. And how disgraceful, the Donald says, that someone might judge my Christianity. But all the Pope was saying was, Jesus prefers bridge building to wall building. It's a surety and a confidence in taking seriously what Jesus took seriously. And that's the original program, one of the hallmarks of the original program is that it seeks to take seriously what mattered to Jesus. And it doesn't want to settle. The original program doesn't settle for purity and piety when we're being invited to holiness. It doesn't settle for the fear-driven when love longs to be our engine. It doesn't settle for a partial and a puny atrophying God when we're being ushered into a wildly spacious, expansive, and generous God, too good to be true. It doesn't settle for practicing the Catholic faith when it can have the joy of living the gospel, as Pope Francis tells us. We don't settle for being faithful to the church when God offers us the bright promise of the kingdom. The original program doesn't draw lines, it erases them. And the gospel in the end doesn't lead me to think that I am somebody, but rather I am everybody in some exquisite kinship. And so we choose, as Pope Francis reminds us recently, the church always reforming, or we stay stuck in the third grade. Nuns on the bus, or a fortnight for freedom. Cup, or chalice. A church of contagious consolation, or a church of collective desolation. Opiate of the people, or smelling salts. A church with its foot on the gas, or a church with its foot on the brakes. A Christianity of depletion and grim duty, or a Christianity of joy upon joy, grace upon grace, close to the gospel bone. I was preaching, did Mass at Challenger, which is a huge consolidation of different camps. And there was it's a huge gym, and they pack in all these guys. And there was a kid named Louie who was in the front row, and I had seen one of the volunteers, a woman, had contacted him before and asked him to do the first reading. And she gets up and says, "Now Louie will help us with the first reading." And she seems to need to kind of tell him to come up, even though I knew she had told him beforehand. But he seemed surprised by this. So he walks up to the podium, and there's the microphone, and I usually stand next to them to help them with any difficult words. And he looks at the microphone, he looks at the reading, he looks at me, he looks back at the reading, and then he goes, "Out loud?" And I say, "Well, yeah, it's sort of the idea." And we're meant to live our lives out loud, not with the volume up. The homies have an expression they use, and it's not for a good situation. They'll say, "Don't talk about it, be about it." And it always means a fight is about to break out, you know. So don't talk your mess. Let's just throw down and settle this. But it's a good piece of advice. Don't talk about it, be about it. Once I was in Australia, and during a question and answer period, a man said, "When do you introduce Christ to the gang member?" And I said, "Never and immediately." And I think that's the way it's supposed to be. Never and immediately. Don't talk about it, be about it. It's about living your life out loud. When I was pastor of Dolores Mission, you know, we had all these things. We had homeless undocumented men sleeping in the church, and we had gang members always milling around in safety by the bell tower, and we had ESL classes and NA classes and AA classes and feeding the homeless. And you looked around, and it was a who's who. Everybody who was nobody was there, drug addict, homeless, gang member. And a man drove up in a fancy car, a Latino, and he leaned out the window and he said, "You the pastor here?" I guess I was the only white guy around, I guess we presumed. I said, "Yeah." And he goes, "You know, I was baptized in that church. I went to school here at Dolores Mission. I grew up in the projects until we were able to move out." Then he takes in all these people with his view, and he shakes his head in disgust, and he says, "You know, this used to be a church." And I said, "Well, you know, people here now think it's finally a church. We want to join ourselves to the original program, because authentic spirituality ought not to end in the privacy of the soul, but in true kinship with the poor, whose highest maturity is tenderness." Francis says an odd thing to us. He says, "Jesus wants to include." He doesn't say Jesus used to include, and he doesn't say Jesus wants you to include. He says Jesus wants to include. It's active. It's present. It's now. And so the original program relearns the gravity of kindness, and the power of the tender heart needs to be activated always. Don't talk about it. Be about it. For it is only the soul who ventilates the world with tenderness who has any chance of changing it. The truth be told, putting on Christ is not the hard part. Never taking him off, that's the challenge. The poet writes, "The sky where you live is no place to lose your wings. So love, love, love." The disciples asked Jesus, "Please increase our faith." And we think we're supposed to add different tenets of our creed or enlarge our reading list. And what it really means is, to what ought we to give our hearts in the tenderness to which we are called? Let me end with a final story. There was a kid I knew named Lulu, a gang member, drug dealer. He lived in Aliso Village. He would ride his bike up to cars and sell crack cocaine until he became his own best customer. He started to get high and high, and I'd see him and I'd say, "Lou, I think it's time, you know, maybe to get some help." And he would always say, "No thanks, G, I'm okay." Until one day it takes what it takes, and he decided that he needed some help. So I drove him to a mountaintop an hour north of Los Angeles, and I dropped him off at a rehab. 30 days later, his brother Eric does something that gang members don't ever do. He put a gun to his temple, and in front of his girlfriend, he killed himself. It's more typical that a gang member filled with despair would walk into enemy territory hoping to die. His homies didn't know what to make of this. It was so direct an action. So I called Lulu at the rehab and I said, I told him what happened, and of course he was devastated. I said, "Miko, I'm going to come pick you up, but I'm going to drive you right back after the funeral." And he says, "I want you to. I like what recovery feels like." So I go pick him up, and he greets me with a big abrazote, and he gets in the car, and right away he launches in, and he says, "I had a dream last night. You were in it." And in the dream, he says that the two of us are in a room, and it's pitch black, a small room. No lights at all, no lights creeping under the door, no illuminated exit signs. It's completely black. He knows that I'm there, but neither of us are speaking. And suddenly, in the darkness, I reach into my pocket and I have a flashlight. And I aim it steadily at the light switch on the wall. And Lulu tells me that in the dream, he says, "I know that I'm the only person who can walk to that light switch. I'm the only one who can turn it on. I'm grateful that you happen to have a flashlight." And so very tentatively, he follows the beam of light and walks to the light switch. And when he gets there, he takes a deep breath and he flips the light on, and the room is flooded with light. And now Lulu is sobbing in the telling of the story. And he says with a voice of remarkable discovery, "The light is better than the darkness." Like he didn't know this to be the case. And then through his tears, he said, I guess my brother never found the light switch. The original program trusts the power of a tender heart, ventilating the world like a flashlight, finding its light switch. The church is not about fear or warnings or terror or defensiveness. It's not a grim duty, but joyful and spacious like our God, who is too good to be true. And the church wants to be now what the world will ultimately become, a place of exquisite kinship. Start the drumbeat. Everything we have said about the friend is true. The beauty of that peacefulness makes the whole world restless. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Father Greg, for this workshop. An announcement: we need the help of all ministers of Holy Communion to assist in the distribution of communion at the arena liturgies. Please sign up at the Ministers of Holy Communion table.